future. Okay, I'm doing it, and okay, now I will go to slides. A second. Share screen. Share. Okay. We are, I hope that you see my slides. We are moving to constraint optimization. So this is, just a second, I should put hand tool pointer. So this is a general formulation of constraint optimization problem, which we consider minimize some function of n variables with inequality functional constraints gi of x less or equal to zero and equality constraints. And you already did it. So this graphical illustration of our problem that we have these lines, these level sets of constraints, say for example this one g1 of x is zero, so on the left is less than zero, it's feasible area, and the same two other constraints. For example, we have three constraints and here are level sets of our objective function, and
Michael, can I ask a question?
Just a second, I want to enlarge it a little bit. Just a second. And of course, we want to find the point with minimal level, which belongs to the level line with minimal value. So we have a such concentric level line, so the one with minimal value will touch our feasible area, and we conclude that this is our solution of the problem. And then we say that gradient is orthogonal to the level line. That's why here gradient of objective function and of the constraint are collinear, which is very, very important, which is written here. And then we will expand the same for the case when more than one constraint is active. Oops. Okay, it's not on my slide. I will have to expand my slide. But here you will have some of two gradients, for example, of active constraints. Okay, I am with you. Who was asking?
Michael.
Yes.
Can I have a question? Okay. So the graphical illustration that you wanted us to do is the left image.
Okay, if you did the left one, it's very good. If you
okay.
if you
no, like did the idea because I thought
the left one explains I would say 90% of motivation, and if you did the right one, it's even better. But the left is good enough. The left is
because the right one just has two constraints.
Yes, two active constraints, and it's important because here you will have more general expression. You say your gradient of your objective function plus sum of weighted gradients of the constraints is zero, and this is.
Okay. Okay, can you explain this? Because in the lecture you explained it a little bit fast and I didn't quite get it. This equation, why it has to be equal to zero, the gradient and the Lagrange.
We say, I will bring another whiteboard because my whiteboard is loaded for something else. Okay. Let's do it here. I will be able to remove the old stuff. Maybe just move it. Accurately. translate it on the whiteboard. Wait a second. Okay. Let me stop. You know, I will start doing it on whiteboard, and then I will switch views. For example, I have two constraints, and the level sets of my objective function. In better pen. Let me see. Which one is better? Okay.
Michael, choose screen sharing.
I will switch. Yes, I will switch immediately. I will stop share, and you will see my screen in video. Okay. I did the larger picture. Okay, and assume beta pen. Okay, this one is good enough. Okay. So those are level sets of my objective. And like we told, minus gradient of the objective minus g, or minus nabla f, goes in this direction. And minus gradients of constraints, they go in this direction, maybe with blue color. This orthogonal to this level line, and the other orthogonal to other level line. And because of this geometry, they meet in the vidhada, in the, how would say, sharp angle? No. Can you help me with English? The vidhada, an angle which is less than
acute.
Actually, it's not hada. It's angle which is less than 180 degrees. Because of this geometry, if we can continue to here in this direction minus gradient of f, you will see that it can be expressed as some combination of those gradients. And this is our claim. In general, it will look like gradient. Say this is g1 equals 0, and this is g2 equals 0. And we will see that gradient of f is some lambda 1. Minus gradient of f, yes? Or gradient of f is lambda 1 gradient of g1 plus lambda 2 gradient of g2. It's hand waving I'm explaining, but I hope that this gives you some intuition, and it's good point to ask questions.
So okay. Is the inequality is worth zero? Why is it the sum of gradient of f plus lambda gradient of the constraint is worth zero for one constraint, not even?
Just a second. For one constraint. I need to do one more picture.
No, it's you could do it for two, just like in particular, just to.
No. For one constraint, I will do small picture. For one constraint, the picture will be the following. Yes. And for one constraint, it's even simpler, because gradient is tangent, is orthogonal to the tangent plane to level line. Here is this minus gradient of G, and here is gradient of F. And they are collinear because those level lines are touching. Let me remove this one. So this is gradient of F. Okay? Is it more or less understandable?
I think, but why it has to be worth to zero? I understand that they
it's what it says, that those two vectors are linearly dependent. One can be explained as a scalar multiplied by another with minus sign. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Okay.
And this is exactly why this equality is possible. Okay. I hope we can continue. Let me get back to screen sharing. Okay. Okay, and this is our most important message. And now so I need to repair a little bit my slides, because it was in the video, but was not on this slide. Now we say that we did define Lagrangian as a sum of objective function plus, where do I have my Lagrangian? Okay, I don't have it here. I will write it again on the whiteboard. Stop share. Okay, let me get back to the whiteboard. And I say I define Lagrangian of x lambda is f of x plus sum lambda I gi of x. Gi are constraints. And of course, when I write down gradient with respect to x of a, this is a nabla of f of x. Plus some lambda I gradients of gi of x. And we just told now that gradient of f can be expressed as linear combination of gradients of g. So this will be zero. And this is our first Kuntaker condition.
I have a follow-up question, Michael. What happens if the GIs are dependent? And what happens, like, graphically, if FX cannot be described as a linear combination of GIs?
Let's say at this point we only analyze, and this is one of part of KKT condition. We only analyze this simple situation, and we say that those conditions which we understand clearly at this stage are when the gradients are independent, and then you can always express if the point is optimal. Then, because of this geometry, that the lowest level set of objective function touches your feasible set, you always have a geometry for this condition.
Okay, thank you.
And for dependent gradients, let leave it out of scope. It's a much more delicate question. And we will touch it one again with penalty function, like it was in the lecture, maybe in a little bit more details now. Okay, let me get back to the presentation. I hope my recording is working. Yes, yes. Share screen. Okay. Okay. So this one, the most important condition. Gradient of Lagrangian is zero, mean gradient of objective function is expressed as linear combination of gradients of active constraints. And of course, constraints should be satisfied. For inequality constraint, it should be less or equal to zero. And from the picture, you see that this is like linear combination with positive coefficients from our picture. And we will re-enter it again with penalty function method. But very important message for inequality constraints that lambda I are non-negative. And we say that lambda is zero for non-active constraints, because for non-active constraints, we just do not include them into sum. Do not include them into this expression. So it's the same like putting them to zero. And those conditions can be expressed compactly, like product of lambda I with gi should be zero, and it has special name complementary slackness. Because when the constraint is non-active, non-zero, then we say that lambda should be zero. And if the constraint is active, again, this product is zero because active constraint itself is zero in the solution.
And can I ask a question about it?
Yes.
This compact formula, we still need the other equations or inequalities. We can't leave them out, right?
Yeah, yes, is just use it in the addition to those.
Yeah, in addition.
Okay. Yes, yes. Or it is actually a consequence of those, but it's often used independently in some analysis. People really like to use it. Because what you have here, actually you have inner product of vector lambda with vector g. And it gives us, when we will learn, for example, semi-definite programming, we will get back to this formula. Okay.
Okay. Well, may I ask a question?
Yes, yes. Yes,
about active constraint, the lambda can be also zero?
It might be zero. It might be, there might be degenerate cases when lambda is zero for active constraints as well. Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Let's see. And then we go to the most important method, penalty function method for solving constraint optimization problems. And we say that we introduce one-dimensional penalty function, which is like here in the picture. And we build an aggregate, yes? We build an aggregate here. Objective function plus penalty functions of every constraints. And we say that when parameter goes to infinity, this penalty, my face is let me get to the previous slide. this penalty become sharper and sharper, it means that we in limit we don't penalize any feasible point and infinitely penalize feasible point. So to the our aggregate becomes just objective function in the feasible area. G is our feasible set, and infinity out of feasible area. So and to minimize this, of course, it's as a to achieve the minimal value of f of x in the feasible area, because we cannot get to any point out of it. Okay. Any questions? At this point, everything is clear. And here is general flow of the method. Just start with some penalty value and minimize approximately penalty aggregate and increase the penalty value at least until it reaches really high values, like say 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6, depend on the scaling of your problem, but quite often those numbers are sufficient.
I have a question.
Yes.
Why do we have to continue raising the P in order to get to the minimal location? I mean, I thought that initially we take the function to be infinity outside the feasible area. So why would we need to continue raising the P?
Okay, thank you. It's good question. Why don't we start with such penalty? Yes. Because usually what people do, they start with such kind of penalty and gradually change it. If you do it gradually, you can minimize it with some reasonable unconstrained method, for example, with Newton method, and then get close to the solution, relatively close, and then make penalty stronger and stronger and get more and more, more close. If you start with this sharp penalty, your unconstrained optimization may become broken, and you may observe it even in your experiments when you will do the next homework on the constraint optimization. So it's just bottom line is just to make unconstrained optimization work smoothly.
Okay. The point of making the penalty function steeper and steeper.
Yes.
Is why, because even if it's not steep but it's big enough, it wouldn't the our yeah. problem wouldn't converge to outside of the feasible area. I mean, it's not.
I don't know. Maybe my objective function has very strong gradient. Yes, and to balance it, I will get a little bit outside of my feasible area when I have such a. Non-strict penalty like is on this, I'm not guaranteed, and you will see it in practice that you get or inside or opposite. For example, it's a solution. Your constraint is active, this particular constraint which you apply this fee. So you know it should be zero, and it may well happen that you end up with points somewhere here, for example. So you will not get to the optimal solution. But if your constraint become more and more sharp, then you're really guaranteed to get more and more close to your solution.
Okay, thank you.
No, please. Okay. Okay, those slides are not related. Actually, we finished with this preliminary part, and I will have more on the connection between the penalty function and Lagrange multipliers, and we can do it after the break. Any question, any comments, and then we go to the break.
Yes, about the feasible set. Do we assume that it is a convex set?
In general, not, because if it is convex, you are guaranteed to get to really global solution. if it is not convex, you might get to some local solution. You're not guaranteed to get the global solution, but to local you can. So the penalty function method may work also to non-convex function. Okay, can you close your microphone with somebody, please?
Yes, I'll try.
Okay. Okay, so let's do 10 minutes break and then we come back. And I will pause recording. Okay. We are back from our break. I hope that everybody is back.
I resumed recording.
Yes. So on my part, it is recording, and I hope on yours also. Okay, and now I prepared new slides regarding this part. It is a little bit challenging, but not so difficult regarding this part related to connection between penalty function and Lagrange multipliers. And I will share my screen again. Okay. Okay. I hope that you see my window.
Yes, I can see it.
So we consider problem with inequality constraints, so minimize some objective function with inequality constraints. And like we told, that we write down Lagrangian. Lagrangian is objective function plus some of Lagrange multipliers, lambda I multiplied by constraints, gi. And we also told that optimality condition is that gradient of Lagrangian with respect to x should be zero. And we get that gradient of objective function plus weighted sum of gradients of active constraints should be zero. Or all constraints, but if we put all constraints, then lambda I for non-active should be zero. Okay. And now, we say that we build a penalty aggregate. We take our penalty function and build penalty aggregate for our problem. Our objective plus some penalties of constraints. And what we do, we minimize, given some value of penalty parameter, given some form of this penalty function, we minimize using, for example, unconstrained optimization method with respect to x. And the interesting observation, when we do it, we can get some approximation to our Lagrange multipliers. Why do I think this? Because if we minimize our unconstrained minimization condition, unconstrained minimum condition is that gradient of this aggregate with respect to x should be zero. And if you write down this gradient, we get gradient of the objective function plus, and here you have a derivative of this penalty function. This is a function of one variable multiplied by gradient of constraint. This is a very, very important part. Any question, any comment with respect to this?
You say that it's not the exact solution for the lambdas because it can happen for any phi that looks like this.
Yes, so, yes, it's not exact solution. When we then will drive our penalty parameter to infinity and get to this sharp penalty, we will get close to solution. But meantime, it's some intermediate observation, but observation is very interesting that we give we get a formula which looks rather similar to the formula of gradient of Lagrangian. Yes, we have here gradient of objective function plus some numbers. This is number, yes, at this concrete point. Phi of g of xp, I didn't write it everything because it takes too much place. But you understand, this is number multiplied by gradient of concern. And now in the next slide, we conclude all picture together. So we see that this is a number, and we even give it special name, lambda I with index p. And this is lambda I. We say this is like our approximation to actual optimal Lagrange multipliers. Ah, by the way, here should be star, lambda I star. Sorry. This. Okay. And what we say, we start looking what will happen. We start looking what will happen when P becomes very large, when penalty parameter goes to infinity. First of all, we observe that our minimizer of penalty aggregate will go to actual solution of the problem. And now we start thinking what will happen with those terms when we become more and more close to solution. First of all, non-active constraints. Non-active, it means that it's not zero. It will not go to zero. It goes to some constant. Constant dependent on index, and all of them are smaller than some universal constant. And then we ask a question: when penalty parameter goes to infinity, what will happen with the slope of this penalty function? Just a second, I will be back. Okay, sorry for one interruption. Okay, so we say that when this function become ideal penalty, the slope become zero, goes to zero. That's why this term will go to zero when our constraint is non-active. And for active constraints, this expression will become like we should compare two formula. This one, optimality condition for Lagrangian, and this one we have here point xp, which becomes more and more close to x star. And there are some more rigorous consideration in the lecture. I will not go to them, but the general idea, when we have the same structure, gradient of f, of course, it goes to gradient of f of x star. Gradient of constraints also goes in limit to gradients of at the point x star, because argument itself goes to x star. And that's why we conclude that also those numbers should go to those numbers. And this is general observation that it's very important, because when we solve with penalty function method our problem, we can get also estimates of optimal Lagrange multipliers. Any question?
Michael, I have a question.
Yes. Yes, yes.
When we find, you said that the derivative at zero is one.
Yes, but I understand your question. You say what will be the derivative of penalty function for active constraints? Yes, when argument
exactly
goes to zero. And if I would look on this area with magnifying glass, when my penalty parameter become large, here in it's like corner in this in very small area, derivative of my penalty function changes from zero to infinity. So in this very small area, it may take any value. So when my g is going more and more close to the origin, but also penalty parameter becomes very large, actually I can achieve any slope as I can. I do it by hand waving, but I hope you understand my motivation.
Yes, but you defined the families you use exactly this way. So even in the limit, it should be one. You understand? Like
it is one in the point zero. But if I have a sequence of arguments, which also come close to zero, and I don't say in which way they come close to zero. So I have two things. I have a penalty function, which I have penalty function. Maybe I need to get some magnifying picture. One second. Okay. Maybe I will again stop sharing my screen. Stop share and drive some picture. So I have a penalty function, and I say that my GI comes to this is GI. For example, it's GI of XP. Okay, so I know that as my penalty become more and more sharp, GI will become more and more close to origin. But it will be in this interval. So when I do larger penalty parameter, I know that my GI will fall into smaller interval. But in this smaller interval, again, penalty function will change its derivative from very small to very large. I hope you understood my idea. I can drive GI to zero and increase in the same time penalty parameter and still have this freedom, the derivative of my penalty function is this interval where GI falls and take any value from very small to very large.
I understand what you say. You say there is no actual limit, so it can be many values.
It can be, yes, it can take many values, but the actual limit exists only because I will get back to my sharing. Okay, and the actual limit exists only because we already have this equality. We know that in the solution, this condition is satisfied for Lagrangian, yes? Gradient of Lagrangian is zero. And I have a process when GI of XP is driven to GI of X star because I am approaching I assume that my constraints are smooth continuous functions, and also gradient of XP goes to gradient of X star. So I have a process when one vector is achieving this vector and the group of other vectors are achieving those vectors, and when they are linearly independent, then by some simple linear algebra consideration, I conclude that also lambda I should go to lambda IP should go to lambda I star. I hope that by hand waving, some additional hand waving, I explain what I wanted. Okay.
Yes, I understood. Thank you. You just claim that the limit exists for any GI. There is different limit which exists, and which is exactly lambda I.
Yes. Exactly. Okay. And we are almost done. We only had in our lecture. I will stop sharing this screen. New share. It gives me possibility of new share. Stop share now. You don't see any sharing now, yes? One second. I should put in the front other screen and share again. Okay. And so this is more or less this stuff. And also one small but important thing, we had a topic of penalty functions, and we had a penalty function for equality constraint, and we had you have equality constraint, that we should take penalty functions that increases in both direction, because we want our argument h to be zero, yes. So we penalize also positive, also negative, like t squared, for example. And there was also notion of barrier method. Quite often, our functions maybe even not defined out for positive values of constraints for x out of feasible area. That's why instead of penalty function, people use barrier method, which goes to infinity from inside feasible area. Okay. Any question, any comments?
Yes, I have a question.
Yes.
In the lectures, you said that in the optimal point x star, the gradient of f plus the sigma of lambda j stars h x stars it's equal to zero.
Just a second.
Here.
Yes. Okay. Yes. It's very similar. I don't return to the motivation.
Should it be the gradient? Sorry.
Thank you very much. Should be gradient. Yes, you're right. Of course. Thank you very much. Okay. Any other question?
Yes. So, what is the motivation of the barrier method?
Okay. Let me stop sharing for a second again. Stop share. So, for example, I will write so this is GI, and I build this family of functions. Instead of just a second, I will put into focus. Instead of penalty functions, before I did it in this way, yes, this was penalty function. This is penalty, and this is barrier. And with barrier similar to penalty function, I may organize a family of functions which goes more and more close to the corner. But they go to the corner from inside. So I am guaranteed that in process of optimization, I never reach the values where my constraints are not satisfied. And this may be important for many numerical algorithms, even for linear programming, when my constraints and objective functions are linear, the barrier methods with logarithmic barrier is proven to have some polynomial what is called polynomial complexity. It means that in reasonable number of steps you achieve good required accuracy of solution. This was the question. Is it enough or you have more?
So I didn't understand when we use this method or the barrier method.
One can try both. One can try both. Sometimes you have even mathematical formulation of your problem where your G and F are not defined out of feasible area. For example, you may have some logarithms or other expression in your objective function, yes? And they are defined only for positive arguments. but also from numerical point of view. So you just should be aware that this possibility exists and apply it in accordance to the need. Okay. Actually, despite of this relatively complicated topic, we finished earlier. Let me check. Yes, actually we finished the main material. So we can stop earlier the main part, but again, who wants to stay for free conversation? We can continue now.
Michael, just in the barrier method, can you just show the slide for 1 second? I wanted to ask about the parameter.
Just a second. Share screen. Okay. So you're asking about this penalty parameter, I guess. Yes?
Yes, I wanted to.
Why it takes a little bit different form than
in to ask if in the argument node.
Yes. Sorry.
Like in the argument of phi, should also be p.
You don't
like
have. No. In barrier method, quite often you don't need p in the argument. You may put it and you may not put it, because pay attention. Again, I should. Stop share. Pay attention. If I take this black plot, yes, and divide it by some large number or multiply by small number, what will happen? Everywhere when this function is not very large, it will become very close to zero. But barrier is built in the way that here it goes to infinity. So if I will divide it by 1,000, it still will go to infinity, but only it will be large only very close to the origin. So I will achieve my goal just by dividing barrier with some large number without putting it into argument, like I did for penalty function.
Okay, thank you.
Please. Okay. So, and maybe you have questions. I think there was in email some questions about homework. It's a good place to ask now.
I have a question about this tutorial.
Okay.
Lecture.
About
it's about what's the meaning of non-active or in why it says it lambda star is zero, it's non-active or something like that.
Okay, good. Let me turn my screen. I still have this picture. Assume that I have one more concern. So this is the basic picture. I will move it a little bit closer. Okay. And assume I even have one more constraint here, G1, G2, and this is G3. And what I say that I achieve a solution of my problem in this case in the corner of in intersection of G1 and G2. And if I perturb these functions a little bit, for example, if I will change parameters in this function, and it will go not in this way, but shifted a little bit. Yes, it's a zero level set. It will influence my solution. So small changes in the structure of those functions influence my solution. And this is one of reasons why they call active constraint. And if I perturb G3, it doesn't influence anything. This is from one hand. From other hand, I got this condition that my gradient, optimality condition is gradient of objective function is expressed as linear combination of gradient of those active constraints. And I can formally put into the sum also non-active constraint, but I put it with zero multiplier, so it will not influence my conclusions. Okay.
So it's active in only if it touches there.
Only if what?
If there is mashik.
Yes, it is in tangent. It is in the place, it's zero in the place where level set of objective function is touching feasible set. Or in other words, it is zero its solution. I call this point X star. This is X star. So all constraints which are zero at X star, they are active.
I have a follow-up.
Yes.
On the combination between an active constraint and barrier method. In the barrier method, I think that we cannot find an active constraint because we can't be at a point where GI is equal to zero.
Yes, but we are approaching the same as in penalty function method. When we put penalty parameter very large, we become more and more close to this point. If we will put penalty parameter 1,000,000 in my picture, you will see the barrier itself, like it's zero here, and goes to infinity. It explodes 1,000,000 in distance 1,000,000 of the origin. So you will become really more and more, you will become numerically close to the solution with barrier methods as well.
I see.
Okay. Okay.
I have a question regarding the KKT theorem. We require at the beginning that the gradients of the constraints need to be linearly independent.
Yes.
But from the picture we see here, they're not linearly independent. So how could we?
Just a second. Our gradient of active constraints here linearly independent. Those two vectors are linearly independent. I'm not asking about non-active constraints.
Only not for the active ones, good, but they aren't.
Good question. Thank you very much for this question. Yes. I'm with you.
These constraints of the gradients of the active constraints aren't linearly independent, so we wouldn't They aren't orthogonal.
Just a second. They are not orthogonal, but they are linearly independent. In two-dimensional plane, what are...
Oh, yes, of course.
If this vector and this vector in the same point are linearly dependent.
I confuse independence with the
orthogonal. I am with you, but I want to explain for others. Because their linear combination will be in the line, and one I can get as some constant multiplied by and by other, but in plane two vectors in general position are linearly independent, but three vectors, for example, always will be linearly dependent. So here are two vectors in different directions. They are independent. Okay. any other question?
Yes, but my question a bit diverged from this topic to the topic of the limit when we take P, the penalty parameter, or the barrier parameter to be large.
Yes. Okay, so what is the question?
I was thinking about what can go wrong with this limit, especially in the case where the end set is not a convex set.
Okay, I am afraid it's not easy to go to those details, because for non-convex problems, you need only use notion of local optimality, and we can take this topic offline. It's bit too loaded to discuss it now.
That's okay. Yeah, that's okay.
Okay. Any other question?
I have a question about the previous lecture with the quasi-Newton.
Tell it again, something not good with your sound.
With the quasi-Newton lecture, I have a question.
Okay, so we get back to our material. Tell your question. Tell it in words, and if needed.
In the rank one update, should we check the Wolf condition, the rank one update guarantees that the matrix will be PSD?
Okay. any case, let me try to get back to the slides. Share screen. Okay, so rank one update is very delicate issue to run it stably. It guarantees symmetry, and by the way, it doesn't guarantee that. Just a second. It doesn't guarantee that your matrix is even positive definite. So there is no restriction under any restriction on Wolf type or other on line search. You are not guaranteed to get positive definite. There are methods which are related to so-called trust region methods, which are combined with rank one update. Why are you interested in rank one update? It's important topic, and it's rather
because in the homework we need to implement a rank one update, and it doesn't converge just to the minima, and we don't know why.
I try to understand. In the homework, you not only required BFGS but something else.
Yes, we should also do rank one.
Okay, but I'm not sure how it is guaranteed. What other students would say?
I didn't say there is a student that succeed to get good results there.
I am not sure that you are guaranteed to get. Maybe if you will start close to solution, you will get. In general, maybe it was asked to show you that rank one is not always good. So actually, okay. The only thing, BFGS is a really good and stable method. And rank one requires much more work to make it.
Yes, the BFGS showed good results, but
okay.
But I wonder if I should check the wolf condition also in the rank one.
No, the answer is no. It will not help in general.
Okay. So, thank you.
Okay, please. Any other question, comment? Okay, so we have a relatively short lesson today, but it's okay.
Can I ask?
Yes.
I have a question about the bonus of the first homework. It's quite general. I'll show you the solution in just a second.
Okay. You mean to compute gradients and check it with finite differentiation? What was
it's to calculate the gradients of a function.
Okay, you can try to show.
Because I did something that, and I'm not sure why it's not good. One of the ones that Amit Arigelim, not